Matt. You guys, you lost Ridgeway to that biceps injury, and now you have T.Y. McGill coming in there. What are some of the things that you've seen how McGill has performed in the time he's been in there on the snaps, and how do you help overcome a loss of Ridgeway?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, first of all, just crushing, you know, to lose Ridge. He was really playing well in his role and doing a lot of good things for us, and I feel for him, you know, for the group, obviously. But, you know, T.Y.'s been up a couple games. And he's played football in this league for a little bit, and the one thing with T.Y., he's got a great get-off. You know, he's a really twitchy, explosive player at that spot, so I think the thing that we've always kind of been impressed with T.Y. is kind of just embraced his role, like knows, hey, I'm going in there to sort of throw my fastballs and be an energy guy and get off and knock people around. And, you know, had a little bit of kind of hidden production, you know, when he played last week in the game. So, you know, we have a lot of confidence in him to step in and fill some of those spots for those snaps. So excited for him and for those opportunities for those guys to come. And but do feel for Ridge, man. He was having a really good season for us, so we're definitely gonna feel the effects of that. But we'll find a way to fill in for him.
Go ahead, Dave, and then Jeff.
And Matt, sometimes it can take a little while for a guy switching from a 34 to a 4-3, just from a passive style to your style. With Javon, I guess we've seen that a little bit. Where is he in that progression, learning the new defense and the new style?
Yeah, I think it's kind of on an upward stroke every week. You know what I mean? He's obviously missed some time also with us, you know, early in the season and not really having the off season and whatnot. But man, he does some things every game where you're like, okay, it's here we go. You know, it's on the come. His get off has been, you know, really really good the last couple games. You know, we're sort of heading in that direction. So I just think. You know, the more he plays and the more he just gets comfortable doing the things we're asking him to do, it's just going to keep going and going. So we actually, you know, we had that little mini practice yesterday and we kind of had a little get off challenge set up for the guys. And I'm not sure if I should say V.1, Vinny won, which is sort of Vinny's the get off king. But Javon was second for the group, you know. So, I mean, he's showing that trend. I think it's just the consistency of doing it, playing and play out. But he's been flashing more and more. So every week it's sort of like more of the flash plays that we've kind of been expecting from him. And we're excited for where he's heading. So I think we're about on the cusp for sort of like falling off the cliff and really getting it playing and play out from him.
Go ahead, Jeff, and then Les.
Sorry about that, Matt. You know, Jim was saying how with Derek Barnett, minimizing maybe some of his moves has helped him narrow the focus on two or three, and also maybe helping him maybe not as much stutter step before he attacks a lineman. Can you talk a little bit more about his development as a pass rusher and in adding more than just that outside speed rush?
Yeah. I think again, sort of a point of emphasis with the whole group for us is just bend that get off, right? Covering ground, like attack mode, right? Getting onto a lineman before they have a chance. And so, you know, with Derek, it's been the same message. And I think he's embraced that. You know, he's, you know, the threat of him getting on the edge, like you said, like that's been something that he's been able to do. You know, if he sort of presents that threat on every play in terms of him getting off and kind of getting into O-lineman space, then it opens up some other things for him. Just in general, with the group, I think sometimes when you have, you know, you're trying to do too many things, like, you know, you can't master those moves or whatnot. And then sometimes that slows your brain down in terms of I'm trying to do this, and I'm stuttering and whatnot. So, you know, for him to just be able to sort of streamline his thought process, and he's been really good in terms of just having a definitive plan of attack every week. Okay, this is what I want to do. This is the approach I'm going to take in our rushdowns, and I'm going to kind of hit him with this, and maybe set him up with a couple counters and those sort of things. So, and we just really were just sort of guided discovery along the way for him. He, you know, he's presenting a lot of his ideas, you know, Derek is, and what he feels comfortable with and what he wants to work on. And we're just sort of encouraging that to sort of that streamlined approach. And again, just really the emphasis on, you know, getting off the ball and covering as much ground as quickly as you can, just really put that threat onto offensive linemen, and that opens up sort of whatever package of moves you want to work with. So, you know, hopefully that this is, you know, the success that Derek's had. And I thought Derek played a hell of a game on Thursday night. I really do. I thought it was one of his better games that I've seen him play. So hopefully that's sort of the trend that we're heading in there.
Go ahead, Les, and then Ed.
Hi, Matt. I was talking to Jim Schwartz about the 80-yard quarterback run Thursday night and how plays like that have kind of been a problem for you guys, not so much running backs running between the tackles, but gimmick plays, wide receivers, quarterbacks running. What do you tell your defensive linemen? There's a lot of talk about rallying to the ball, obviously, but then you lose gap containment and so forth. How do you guys talk about plays like that? What do you say to your linemen?
Wait, what did Jim say when you asked him?
I asked him to what can be done to stop it.
Yeah, no, I'm just teasing. You know, again, like, I think the message is always whenever you chase plays, like, you put yourself in harm somewhere else, right? So, you know, we try to operate within the scheme of the defense and what Jim's asking us to do up the front. And, you know, sometimes that's involved, you know, with the quarterback runs or whatnot. A lot of times it's not, you know, depending on, you know, schematically what we're doing. So, you know, again, yeah, one of our staples of what we believe in our group is running the ball. You know, and again, you see us, you know, trying to make plays, you know, and getting on hits downfield on those jailbreak screens or reverses or whatever it is. So, you know, we're gonna execute our scheme and stop the whatever element of that run play that we're designed to stop. And then the second level of that for us is just we're always promoting getting the ball. Again, it's why we rotate guys. It's why we, you know, play the way we play. So, you know, if it's not something that is, you know, schemed up for us to handle in that element of the run game, then, you know, our contribution is us turning the ball. And again, maybe one of those times, you know, one of those runs gets turned back and we got a D lineman running inside out, makes a big hit. You know, maybe that discourages some of those things in the future or whatnot. Or, you know, we save a play down the field, you know, that gives a chance to put the ball down and play again, and we hold into a field goal instead of a touchdown. So, I mean, the mentality is just, hey, let's all get to the ball, right? We're going to execute our scheme and play the run part of what we have to play from a front. And then whenever anything breaks out or gets on our perimeter, we're turning and running, and we'll see how that goes. And generally, you know, those lead to more positive plays. So we're just trying to promote, like we always do, getting guys to the ball and running downfield. And whether that's forcing turnovers, you know, getting a big hit, forcing fumbles, or even getting a guy on the ground to live to fight another day. I mean, that's part of our job. So that's really how we approach those plays.
Ed and then Martin.
Hi, Matt. Just, you know, we talked about a little, you know, the thinning of the D tackle ranks a little bit. I mean, how close is Raekwon Williams to making a contribution? How has he looked, you know, on scout team, and, you know, how's he doing?
Ray's been great. We're very excited with him. Honestly, he's a great worker. I mean, he's just just enthusiastic. He's great to be around every day, like takes great notes. I mean, he is just, he's a guy we're very excited about his future. I mean, in terms of, you know, contributions, I mean, that's not necessarily my world. In terms of, you know, roster construction, we've been working with Ray every day. He has an edge to him. He plays tough. He's really, I think he's been developing day and day. So I'm very pleased with where he is and on his track and what we're doing with him. And I think whenever that decision is made, or if it's ever made, like I know Ray's going to put himself in a position to be successful and do what we're asking him to do. So I'm excited for him to just keep on the track that he's on. Like I said, he's been good. He does a lot of work for us, you know, day in and day out. I practice and individually stays after, comes early, all that stuff. I mean, everything you would ever want, you know, from a young player, he's doing. So, you know, if an opportunity arises for him to contribute, I think he'll make sure he's ready to do so.
Martin and then Paul.
Hey, Matt. Brandon Graham is obviously off to probably one of the best starts of his career. I mean, what have you been seeing from him? And you know, obviously he had the big clutch strip sack against Daniel Jones Thursday night. Just how well is he playing overall and everything?
Yeah, I think, you know, I've only been, you know, obviously Ben was only here last year to see it firsthand. So I can't really necessarily compare it to the rest of his seasons. But I think he's playing at an elite level. I mean, I really do. I don't, you know, I think sometimes Brandon gets overlooked a little bit, you know, just kind of a steady guy, and everyone's like kind of just expects him to be there and do what he does and stuff. But I think he's playing at a high, high level. I mean, at this point in the season, I'd put him up against any other guy in the league. I mean, from, you know, production numbers, rush numbers, sacks, you know, TFLs, hits. I mean, he's just been very productive. And obviously, you know, you guys know BG. I mean, has never lost his, you know, energy and affection. I mean, that's the coolest thing. I mean, even I think he's had as much of an impact for us, you know, with no fans and then limited fans and just sort of, you know, having to generate energy and be that guy for the group. I mean, he's awesome. He's just an amazing person to be around. And then so obviously for him to have the success, I mean, he's competing at a high, high, high level. I mean, I think, again, league-wide right now, I would put him up there with the top guys. So, again, it's all about consistency in this league and being able to continue to do it for, you know, a whole season, not a half season. And, you know, I have confidence the way BG prepares himself and practices and gets himself ready to play every week and whatnot that I hope the success continues for him because he's again, obviously the sacks numbers are good. I know he's sort of in the top of the league in terms of sacks. But it's everything. I mean, he is a force in the run game. He's setting edges for us. Like I said, he's got a bunch of TFLs. He's hitting and pressuring the quarterback, even when those sack numbers aren't necessarily, you know, always showing up. So, BG deserves a lot of love, man. He's having a great year.
We'll wrap it up with Paul, Bo, and then Zach.
Yeah, Matt, a follow-up on BG. I mean, he's not a dinosaur, but he's 32 years old. Are you surprised by the level of play at that age? And going into the season, how did you think you'd approach his snap percentage each game? Did you think you might have to limit, you know, to monitor it, or just you never had any concerns with him?
We monitor all those guys. So, you know, there's – again, the way we play our defensive front, there's always, you know, we try to rotate guys and just across the board to keep fresh. And then obviously guys that have some more miles on them, you know, that you try to be aware of that. I just a testament to BG, you know, he took a concerted approach this offseason to, you know, get himself in even better shape. And he changed his diet a little bit. You know, did some other things from a workout perspective that, again, you know, sometimes, I was around some guys like Cam Wake that, you know, had success, you know, as an older player, and even like Kyle Vannebosch at the end of his career and those sort of things. And, you know, I think the guys that understand, hey, you can't necessarily always do things the way you've done them, right? As you get older, you have to change some of your habits and adjust to keep, you know, just it's not as easy to, you know, I can speak for myself, I won't speak for you guys, you know, like, it's harder to stay in shape, you know, when you get older and do those certain things. And so, you know, I really give like a lot of credit to BG. I mean, when you know, we first got this job and I talked to him a little bit and we made a concerted effort for him to be aware of that. And he really attacked this offseason, which was not obviously an easy offseason to do that from a nutrition standpoint, from a workout standpoint. And I think the efforts that BG put in through the offseason are showing now that, he prepared himself to handle, you know, the season in a way that, you know, again, he may not have had to do this, some of those things 10 years ago or 8 years ago, whenever that may be. But, you know, I think he's embracing the fact that as his career advances, that he's got to, like, even be sharper on some of those things and just take care of his body a little better. And he's really done that. And I think, you know, he doesn't look like a guy that's got a ton of miles on him. He's been, you know, like I said, been obviously high energy and performing at a high level. And, you know, I give him all the credit for what he did this offseason and how he approached coming into the season to allow himself to sort of play the way he's been playing.
Bo and then Zach.
Hey, Coach, you mentioned the get-off drills before. And, you know, Josh Sweat, it feels like that's an area where he's made a big improvement. Last year, it seemed like he was often – you know, one of the last guys off the ball. Is that fair to say? Do you agree with that? And how have you gone about, you know, changing that?
You say last year he was one of the last guys off the ball? I'm sorry.
It seemed like at the beginning of last season, it seemed like he was often slow to get off the ball. Yeah. But now, I mean, he looks like one of the first guys.
Yeah, well, obviously, I would just say this. Obviously, Josh is an explosive player. And, you know, again, just we've tried to just – like Salam, I hate to be a broken record here, but just similar to a lot of guys. I mean, with Josh, a lot of times it was his stance and fiddling with his stance and not kind of getting right. So we try to, again, streamline things. And, you know, part of the beauty of this defense is for the front is it just takes some of the thinking out of it. You try to take some of the thinking out of it. You know what I mean? Once you get in your line and you're lined up on your track and then, you know, hitting where you're supposed to hit, it's about getting off the ball and being explosive. And Josh has that capability. He's obviously one of the more explosive athletes we have in the room. So I think probably similar to some of the other guys we've talked about, it's just it's been a matter of him just streamlining that. And again, just for Josh, almost a repetitive motion, right, of just being able to, like, repeat the same stance and the same get off because his ability is there clearly. And he's got juice and he's got length to cover ground when he does do that, you know, those sort of things. So I think Josh, again, has just embraced the sort of like I can get in a comfortable stance and do it the same way and repeat it and not be fiddling, which sometimes, you know, sort of you tinker too much and you're not getting what you want out of what you know, your stance or your get off or whatever it is. So I think he's been great. He's been explosive and it's been good. You know, again, like we've got a lot of competition in that room. So it does become a competition and we promote that guy, you know, guys are talking about it and they don't want to be the last one off the ball. I mean, it's pretty easy when you got the clicker to freeze the frame and see who's the first off the ball and see who's the last off the ball. And so it kind of becomes a thing. And when you put it in the consciousness of the whole group, it just kind of generates more of that. So Josh has done a really good job with his get off and take off this year for sure.
We'll wrap it up here with Zach.
Hey, Matt, as somewhat of a follow-up to that on the topic of rotating these edge rushers, this is a chicken or an egg question, but when you see their production, do you think it merits more playing time or someone like Sweat getting the production he has because of the snaps he's taking?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's pretty much what I grapple with every week. So if you got answers, I might turn it back on you at some point. But yeah, it is. I mean, it's a fine line. Like I said, we want to keep these guys fresh, right? Part of the way we play. And even to the earlier question about, you know, the perimeter runs, right? Like, if we're asking guys to turn and chase the ball 30 yards downfield a lot every play and give us everything you have and get off and launch and attack, I mean, like, you build that mentality, like, there's only so many snaps in a row you can do that in, you know what I mean? And so the fine line of saying, okay, where's the production of saying, okay, this guy's getting sacks or getting whatever the production metric you want to use, you know, where's that line between, like, getting all that production and maximizing it versus damaging it by wearing a guy down or playing too many snaps in a row. And again, I think the beauty of the group where we're at, you know, hopefully right now is we've got a lot of versatility in the room and a lot of answers at different spots and again, healthy competition where the guys are going back and forth. So that is the balance that you always looking for in terms of, okay, like what's too much, you know, what's not enough and how do we maximize, again, not just a guy like Josh, but all those guys in the room. And you know, we want all of them to have success and the group to have success. So, yeah, and I'm a little ducking on that one because it's hard. It's sort of week to week, you know what I mean? Again, and obviously, you know, like going on the short week, you know, last week had a sort of different approach to things versus, you know, you got a little bit of a longer week leading into this game here. So I think it's week to week and you do look at, okay, weekly the productions changes and matchups change week to week with who we're seeing from an offensive perspective and you know, schematically and those sort of things. So I do think there is a balance or a fine line of bouncing. Yeah, this guy's producing versus, okay, where is that drop off going to happen if we play them too much? And that's probably a weekly thing, to be honest with you. And like I said, it's just a lot of factors go into that. And that's what I pull my hair out every Saturday night, trying to figure out how to deploy everybody and make sure we're getting the most out of the group and winning some more ball games, hopefully.
We'll get started with Tim McManus and then John McMullen.
Hey, good morning. Curious what you've seen behind the scenes with Jalen Reagor as he continues to work to get back on the field, and what are you expecting?
You know, it's hard right now. We really hasn't had a chance to practice, really. You know, we're just trying to see where he's at. We'll make our evaluation as the week goes on, but you know, we'll see. There's not too much to really say. We got to get ourselves in a position where we're allowing him to run around and do the football stuff that we need him to do, and we'll make a decision when he's ready. But you know, that's not really a decision I make. We'll be part of the end process there.
Go ahead, John, and then Les.
Hey, Aaron. Travis Fulgham, obviously, arrived here pretty late, I think August 20th. What has it been about him that has enabled him to embrace this offense and be such a key contributor so quickly?
Well, you know, Travis is a smart guy. He works really hard, and he's got a knack for making plays. And I think that as he kind of got into our offense and started to learn the offense the way we call it, he's been fortunate enough where he was in a West Coast offense before, so he had some of the terminology was pretty much the same, and you know, that allowed a little bit of kind of room for him to step in quicker. But, you know, a guy has made plays, and the quarterbacks trust him, and when you throw the ball up to a guy and he's going to go up and fight for it every single time, and he's going to go and run routes and do it crisp and kind of, he's tweaking a little bit of his technique just to make sure that it's the way that we want to do it. But he did that quickly. And as he was doing things on scout team, you started to take notice of him doing that. And, you know, he was able to get up and go do the things in the game that he was doing during practice. And that's where, you know, as a coach, you kind of have to wait and see. And he was able to do that against San Francisco, and he's just gotten better and better each week. And just excited to see where the rest of the year can take Travis.
Les and then Zach.
Hey, Aaron. Someone like DeSean Jackson, what do you say to him? He worked so hard to get back out there, and he's seriously injured in his first game back. How do you deal with that with him? What do you tell him? How do you handle him?
Well, you know, it was tough. He was obviously the first thing I did when I came in the locker room after the game is you're emotionally excited about what just happened with you know, Boston, and then BG makes the sack strip fumble, and then you run in the locker room, and the first thing I think of is DeSean, and run in and see him and check on him in the training room, and, you know, just told him to keep his head up and told him to you know, just you know, we'll see where this thing goes. Obviously, we get the news that it's a little more serious than maybe we thought, and he needs to go on IR. And you know, we text a little bit on Sunday and just checking with him. And he was with his boys and you know, and just told him just to lean on his family and lean on the guys in the room and you know, that we're here for him. And that's all you can say. I mean, there's not a lot to say. He's you know, he's in a tough spot. He knows that as far as just how hard he worked. And we all felt terrible about what happened. And, you know, we got to know that there's a little piece of us that's playing for him for the time being.
Go ahead, Zach, and then Paul.
On the topic of Travis, I'm asking you as a former receiver and as someone who's recruited players, has drafted players, coached at all levels here. How does it be that someone can, you know, be cut by a few teams, have the path that he did, and then step in and have the production that he has?
You know, in this day and age, it's amazing sometimes, you know, but, you know, you look at a guy who didn't play football his whole life. He only played the latter part of his high school career. And then, you know, kind of went, as the walk-on deal over to ODU and ended up becoming a great player there, and then, you know, gets drafted. And sometimes, you know, things happen within you know, your time somewhere. Maybe it's you get comfortable. Maybe it's you start, you know, some things are going on in your personal life. Maybe it's, you know, the you and the quarterback aren't on the same page. Maybe it's you and the coaching staff aren't on the same. I mean, there's things that happen, you know, and I can't say that one thing or another has happened to Travis, but I know this, when he came here, there was a sense of comfort. There was a sense of, something about him as soon as he got here, as he started practicing. I don't know if it was some weight off his shoulders. Maybe he didn't feel any pressure, but all of a sudden the guy just starts making plays, and he keeps making plays. And then you put him in the game, and the same thing happens. And you know, right now, you know, he's playing really good football, and I can't attest to what happened in Detroit or Green Bay. But you know, there seems to be a guy or two every year that this happens to, and recruiting isn't exact science when you're talking about high school kids to college, and the draft isn't exact science when you're talking about college kids to pros, and free agency isn't an exact science when you're talking about guys later on. But I'm hopeful that that Travis continues to do what he's done and continues to work hard and continues to be a big part of this offense this year.
Paul and then Bo.
Aaron, Greg Ward has become Carson's most trusted third down receiver. He leads the team in third down catches for first downs. What makes an effective third down receiver, and what specifically makes Greg so good on third down?
Well, I think there's two main factors, in my opinion. You got to have quickness, and you got to have there's three. You got to have quickness. You got to have some sense of timing with the quarterback and timing of the defense of, you know, if they're bringing pressure of when you need to be in the certain spot and then having to feel the defense. So, you know, Greg has all of those. He's a smart guy. He does a good job of catching the ball in contested situations. And Greg has been a stable piece of this offense since I've been here. And I know that's been a short time. I know his time here playing has been a short time, but you would have never guessed that from when I got here. He's a mature guy that understands football, understands spots, understands leverages. And I think that when you look at Greg's body of work, he's been a guy that Carson can rely on in those tough spots. And especially with Zach being out, with Dallas being out, I mean, guys have to step up and be that safety net for Carson. And I think that Greg's providing that right now and really has been the entire season. But for our room, has been a guy that Carson knows that on third down, he can rely on Greg being in the spot that he's supposed to be in and make the play for him.
Do these other young guys look up to him? I mean, has he quickly become a leader in that room?
Absolutely. I mean, Greg does things the right way. At practice yesterday, just a short, you know, get in and get out practice, get the guys' legs moving after the weekend, and Greg's, you know, one of the last guys out on the field, and they better be looking at him. They're crazy if they're not looking at him. So he's but he's a guy that when guys have questions in the room, they ask him, and that's good, and that's what a leader should be.
Oh, and then Daniel.
Hey, Aaron. You know, John Hightower seems like sort of a quiet guy, but you know, it's happened that on the field, like he keeps getting in these sort of feisty shoving matches with the opposing corner. You know, what is behind that, and you know, what is he sort of like on the field?
He's a competitor, you know, and that's what this deal's about. You can be quiet as you want off the field. When you step on the field, your game better be loud, and that's what NFL football is about. And John is a guy that, you know, he's not the biggest guy in the world. He's 190 pounds or whatever. He's gained some weight since he's been here. But when we played Washington, I thought he played a little timid, and I told him that. And I said, if you want DBs to be pushing and shoving you all year long, then go out and play timid. And they're going to treat you like that. And we played L.A. in the second game, and the first play of the game he was in, him and Ramsey got into it, and I said, there it is. There's competitive juice is coming out of him, and he basically went out there and said, I'm not going to let you push me around, and he's done it every game, and we've had to kind of pull him back a little bit after he got the penalty out in Pittsburgh, but there's something to that where, you know, if you're a rookie receiver, I don't care if you're a first-round pick or you're an undrafted guy, DBs are going to go after you, and that's part of the NFL. It's just, and so I just let him know, and you know what? He accepted the challenge, and John is a guy that's continually gotten better. You put the tape on from game one, and you put the tape on from this week against the Giants, it's a whole different player. And that's what rookie receivers do. Travis is essentially a rookie receiver. You see him getting better. Obviously, John and all these guys are young players that are just kind of week by week pushing the envelope to get themselves better. And They should be better from game one to now. But John is constantly kind of learning little details within his game, and I think that the results are starting to come out for him, and we just got to make sure it's consistent and make sure that he's doing the little things every week to ensure that it keeps getting that way.
Go ahead, Dan and Chris.
Hey, Aaron. We talked to Quez Watkins a couple weeks ago, and he talked about how when he was on IR, Carson would come to him, quiz him a little bit on the offense, on the game plan, really keep him engaged. What have you seen in that interplay, with Carson and, guys like Jalen and Quez who have been injured, and then just the rookies in general?
Yeah, it's hard when you're hurt, and because you're focused on that week, you're focused on that game, and Quez being hurt at the beginning obviously hurt him a little bit of just his development. Jalen's kind of in the same boat as far as development, but you still have to pull them along because, especially in 2020 with COVID and all these different things that have been going on, these guys have to be ready to play. And Quez has done a good job when he's been in there. And Carson really likes these young guys and enjoys throwing them the ball. They run hard. They run fast. They're competitive. And they attack the football. And I think that Quez is doing a great job. And he's just got to continue to develop his skill set, continue to attack things. And I think that Quez is going to be a really good player here.
We got time for one more, so we'll wrap it up here with Chris.
Hey, Aaron, Alshon's been out there practicing for the last couple weeks. How has he looked in your opinion? And also, how is he looking when it comes to the breaks, when he has to break in and out of different routes as well, too, especially with that coming off that foot injury?
Yeah, I mean, Alshon's kind of just getting himself back into it. He hasn't done a whole bunch, and we're just trying to, like I said, just get him back as soon as he can, and you don't want to rush it back. And so when he's ready to go, he'll be in there and we'll see where he's at. But, he right now, with him, we're just continuing to evaluate him on a daily basis. And when he's ready to go, he'll go. And I'm not trying to duck and dodge the question. It just is what it is right now with him as far as that goes. And we all know what type of player he can be when he's ready. But, as of right now, just doing some individual things and getting a little bit into team stuff as he can. And as soon as he's ready to go, he'll be out there rolling.
All